Morning, sir. I'm a little late. But my name is Jared Williams. Happy to have you all here today. I found out last week that I can't bend the mic, so hopefully it'll be easier to hear today. Maybe. I'm just going to mess it up. For announcements this morning, Carol asked me to remind everybody that chili dinner meeting is after church on January 30th. If you could please return the jars by the end of February. Also, we're not planning on Thursday worships. That will start the first week of February as planned there, for Thursday afternoon worship. I'm going to work out with council this week what time we're thinking. So we'll have more info for the Thursday afternoons then. Annual meeting was scheduled this March 10th, I believe, correct? Yeah. Yes? Okay. Annual meeting is March 10th after service.
Council elections are February 13th.
Council elections February 13th. Any other one? Nope. Moon Beach, tomorrow is the last day. Right now we are 10 people. As a reminder, you have to show the proof of vaccination and the proof of a negative COVID test day prior before going. So we're 10, we need 16. If you are planning on going, then tomorrow is the last day to get your registration in. And the half the meeting is due. So just let Shelly know tomorrow morning and we'll go from there. So if not, either way, Sunday Fun Day is also going to be that weekend. February 6th, I believe, is that Sunday. We are planning currently on sledding, as far as I know, over at Maple Landing. I've not been there yet. So pretty excited, you know. I haven't been sledding in years, but I think it's going to be fun. So bring your kids, bring your sled, come hang out, it'll be great. Any other announcements at this time? Perfect. Well, I invite literally just up today. Nope, I don't know. Let me finish the theme. We'll get into the opening. I'm all day moving this morning. Now we're going to sing. So our theme for the day, today we'll focus on a passage from 1 Corinthians, at the focus scripture, as we look at what it means for us to all be members of Christ's body on earth here today. And so the question we're really thinking about is, what does it mean to be Christ's body in motion when we are made up of many different people, many different members, with different gifts? That's what to think about during the scripture reading today. With that being said, if you're comfortably able to do so, please rise for our opening hymn. This is the day, number 84.
Peace.
Peace.
Please join me in that.
worship. This day is holy to the Lord your God. Let us come again to see, hear, and touch the word of God. Do not mourn or weep, and do not be grieved. How can we be sad when we can experience God's word and know God's love through our worship together? The joy of the Lord is our strength. Let us come together to worship God with joy, strength, and love. O God, give us strength when we feel weak. We gather to hear your word, sing your songs, and give you praise. We know that you are always with us, and we are grateful. Help us to live our lives in ways that show you are near. Thank you for your presence and constant care for us, in worship and in each day of our lives. Amen. Our next hymn will be the church's One Foundation.
Providing one's very being. God's laws are faithful, making naive people wise. God's regulations are right, gladdening the heart. God's commands are pure and light to the eyes. Know that you are loved and forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Our scripture reading this morning is from the New Testament, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 to 31. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are only one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free. We were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. And if the ear would say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members of the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with great honor. And our less respectable members are treated with great respect. Whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you a still more excellent way.
Okay. Our gospel reading today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4. Verses 14 through 21. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report of him spread through all the surrounding country, began to teach in the synagogues, and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Because he was anointed to bring good news to the poor, he has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." I'm going to switch out the mics, and that's the end of our gospel reading.
This one out?
Yeah.
Now, there we go. sermon today. How many of us have ever done a form of team building exercises? I used to love doing them, you know, as a camper and counselor at Roman Heights down in Iowa. Later on in basic training, I knew all the tips and tricks, and so the drill sergeants told me I had to be quiet because I'm making it too easy for the rest of the trainees. Some of these exercises, they would rely on trusting one another. Others would rely on moving in sync with those around you. Some were just playing problem solvings, puzzles, you know. One example might be we'd all have a hula hoop. We'd all have one finger on this hula hoop circled up together. We had to lower it together as a group, all the way to the ground, and then rise back up, which, you know, sounds really simple, but we only have the one finger, so it's really easy to slide off. The other one, though, that I really want to talk about today was the human knot. A group of us would arrange together in a circle, then we reach across and grab each other's arms, a different arm for each person, so all your arms are tangled into this knot together. And then, the goal after that would be to untangle yourself into a circle. And some are unsolvable if you don't grab the right arms, but it involves a lot of bending and ducking and stepping over and twisting. And then for an added challenge, once you solve it once, you can go back through and do it without talking. That's even harder, but it's a great team building. You learn to trust each other. These team building exercises, they're one of the first places that my mind jumped to or reading Paul's letter to Corinthians today. You see, the church at Corinth was having a problem, and it was a pretty major one. Paul almost always writes all of his letters for a very specific reason. That reason or occasion for his writing is almost always stated very early in the letter. So if you go back to chapter 1, he'll praise the church and say, "You guys are doing really good things." And then he'd say, in his second paragraph, "Here's what you're doing wrong." You know, and he addresses it. So we learn in the first chapter, in the case of 1 Corinthians, that Paul has received word from one of the members of the church that people are claiming to be set up in different camps, you know. Some claim to belong to Paul, others to Apollos or Cephas, and still others are claiming Jesus. And this is creating a great division within the congregation there, within that church, because each person believes that their patron is the right one. And this is happening for a variety of reasons, but perhaps the main one is that Christianity was emerging from multiple cultures, you know, with different understandings of religion. It was the group that was following Apollos, who had been there when Paul originally started the church. It was a group following Cephas, who had become quite a leader within the church since Paul left. There were the people who believed to follow the true founder of the church, and in their eyes, this was Paul, a man who came and started to settle there. And then there were the people who claimed Christ. So all these differences in beliefs were causing this major division because each group believed they were right, and if only the other group could see their way, then the church would flourish. And it really sounds to me like Corinth needed a team-building exercise together. So that's all in chapter 1, and that brings us to our passage today, where Paul here is trying to demonstrate to the congregation that all of them are necessary. Each of the gifts that they provide, and all are unified through being the body of Christ. He's just finished a segment before the passage that we hear as discussing different spiritual gifts that the Holy Spirit has given to different people. And then he moves into this wonderful metaphor of individual members of the body, making up the body as a whole. No one member can look to the other and say, "Because you don't do what I do, you're not a member of this body." No member can truthfully say by itself, "I'm not a part of the body," because it's already there, it's already present. Paul goes on to talk about the parts of the body we traditionally think to be lesser, you know, or weaker, being some of the most indispensable parts, you know. If you think about it, like our fingers, they're pretty fragile in the end, you know, but they're all necessary to set us apart from the animal kingdom, our thumbs in particular, or our hearts, when pierced, we quickly die. But without our heart that so easily gives way, we have no life. And Paul brings this metaphor full circle in verse 27 when he says, "Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it." Wow. Picture that we are all Christ here on this earth, part of his body. I'd like to believe the Corinthians were blown away with this realization of the unity in Christ, and that they saw more clearly how to operate as individuals in a body. and a family. Now, there's a Christian band called Casting Crowns that takes us a step farther in their song, If We Are the Body. And I love that song and the questions they raise during it. It's a more necessary modern interpretation of the passage, I believe. Because I would argue that, unlike the Corinthians, we don't have many modern issues of hand, people saying, I belong to this person or that patron saint, in the way the Corinthians were. The Corinthians were a very global setting where the division was happening. You know, you could say that amongst Christians today, we have a pretty solid understanding we all belong to Christ, despite the denominational differences. What Casting Crowns offers up is asking that if we are the body of Christ, then why is the body not in motion? Why are we silent? And the refrain of the song goes like this: but if we are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing them that there is a way? There is a way. And it begs the question, if we are individual members of the body of Christ's very manifestation on this earth, then how can we continue to show his love in our communities, to be his body in motion? And see, Paul's last paragraph in the passage raises some necessary points. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? Each of us in this church has our gifts that we bring to this team, this family. Just as each of us has things that we are not as good at as others around us. Hands are meant for very different purposes than feet, yet both are still necessary for the body to function as God made it. So what are your spiritual gifts? Is it the gift of working with children? Perhaps it's the gift of working with your hands. Maybe you're musically inclined, or maybe you're extroverted and charismatic. You might be able to look at a biblical passage and easily understand what it's saying. Or you might be an artist who can depict beautiful stories in your medium. All of these gifts are wonderful and necessary, and none is better than another. So how then will you offer them up here at PCCC? How can we show Christ's love better into our community? It kind of fit with the theme of call we had last Sunday. This is actually the lecture I'm preaching from today. But I ask one more time, you know, where do you feel called individually, and where is this body of Christ here in this moment called? And to show Christ's love, we can't keep it only to the sanctuary. This is a safe place where we can hoard it and keep it to ourselves. But Christ calls us, just as he called Paul, to go out into the world, to spread his love, to spread his message. Christ calls us to love our neighbors as we love ourselves, and that means more than just here with the members around us. And something else to consider that pops up today in our gospel passage is, how would we react if Jesus showed up in our church today? How would we react if he was here in this moment? Would he be proud of the work that we are doing? Would he lift us up to others as an example to follow? And I ask these questions from a place of wondering. I'm still learning what I'll do here at Peace. I just learned a new thing with Joel this morning. I got to attend a mission meeting this week. I got to have a youth group meeting with Kelly. I got to meet the personnel. There's wonderful work going on in this church. But it's still a great question to ponder. How would we react if Jesus showed up today in our congregation? Because the gospel passage shows us what happened when he went home this week. Jesus has just returned back to Nazareth shortly after beginning his ministry in the Galilean region. In Luke's narrative, he has not called any disciples yet, but he has been baptized by his cousin John and has been tempted in the wilderness for 40 days. He started preaching the word. He has started preaching, and word about him has spread all over the region. And one day he decides to return back to his hometown, and as is common, I think, you know, when we go home, we want to go to our home church. So he goes to his home synagogue while he's there. There's a deep connection having grown up in that place with those people. And during the service, he gets up and he reads the scriptures, and he reads it in a way they weren't used to. He reads it like he wrote it himself. And the whole congregation is just in awe by this. But if you read past where the lectionary stops it, he He then tells the crowd they won't be performing any miracles for them because they don't need the miracles. And they freak out. They try to throw him off the cliff. They try to kill Jesus, who came to his home church. Imagine being that upset and saying that you don't need to be healed. That's crazy to me. Imagine being in a congregation so hungry for Christ to do something amazing that when he says you don't need it, the first response is anger. And the takeaway here in our modern era, being that we are Christ here on earth, we are what's left. We are the ones called to work miracles in Christ's name. Being Christian isn't a subscription club that you're baptized into and then you receive only rewards like forgiveness and blessings. It is work. And last week we said together in our UCC statement of faith, one of the biggest lines in that statement to me is, he calls us into this church to accept the cost and joy of discipleship, to be his servants in the service of men. The cost and joy of discipleship. I think the people of Nazareth, they were looking for the joy without considering the cost. Because the cost is work, because we are Christ's hands and feet on this earth. What I would like to leave us with this morning, some ponderings for the week ahead. Things for you to consider individually and as a congregation. What are your individual spiritual gifts? What are this church's overall gifts? Where are you called personally to use them in your life and the life of the church? And lastly, if Jesus came through those doors today, how would we react? I'd like to share a story to just to get you guys thinking. I recently had coffee last week or 2 weeks ago, and it was with somebody who's come to this church for a couple of times over the last few years, and they said one of the biggest things that stuck out to them coming here was each time that they came, there was a lady that, while they were still parked across the street, was greeting them before they even made it to the door. That's a gift. I got to meet with the missions committee this week. Those ladies, I think, reflect the congregation's gift of generosity. William, John, and Tim, this past week and the week prior, they have all shown their gifts of handiness with helping out around the church. Sunday Funday is a show of the gifts of creativity and teaching. What I'm getting at is each and every one of you gathered here this morning, you all bring something special to this church. You all bring a gift. This church would not be what it is without all of you being who you are here today. Just never forget that. We are the beautifully broken and beloved community of Christ's body here on earth, who are called to motion, and who are loved beyond measure by a man whose own hometown tried to kill him. So if some of you may please reflect. Reflect and bring your ideas and findings. Reflect and know that you, each one of you, is a member of Christ's body. Amen. With that being said, I know we have a couple of joys and concerns to lift up this week. Are there any other pastoral prayer concerns or joys that you'd like to lift as a congregation? I invite you to please pray with me in your way as I pray mine. Dear God, we come before you this morning humbled, recognizing that we are your body, still here on this earth. We ask forgiveness for the times when we have not moved in directions you have called us. We say thank you for all the forgiveness you've given us before. We ask, Lord, this week in particular, that you be with the family of the Seaforths. Be with them as they grieve a loss that none of us should have to bear. We ask, Lord, that you be with all the people who are hurting right now in this wintry depression season. Let your healing light find their way into their darkness. Let us be a part of that light as you have called us to be. We say thank you, Lord, for the gifts that you have given us. We ask that you show us how best to use them in these weeks going forward. Lord, we say this using the prayer that your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, do so, please rise and join us in our ascend in Christ the Risen Easter Lights number 395. Please join me on our closing hymn, Blessed Be the Ties That Bind, number 393. Yours are the feet, yours are the eyes, you are his body. Christ Christ has no body now on earth but yours. Go forth and do good work. Amen.